Hello again and welcome to another Contacts with Conway. Today's guest is Dr. Tom Arnold from Sugarland in Texas. Tom has practiced there since he opened his first practice in 1992 and has specialised in the fitting of scleral contact lenses for the past 10 years. He co-chairs the International Congress of Scleral Contacts, the ICSC, which was the first meeting of its type internationally devoted solely to the fitting of scleral contact lenses. I began our conversation by asking Tom what first sparked his interest in fitting scleral contacts. If you would prefer to watch this video with subtitles, please click on the cog in the bottom right-hand corner of your screen and select your preferred language.
Well, I was kind of pushed into it, actually. I've been in practice 36 years. I've had my own private practice now for 28. And always focused on contacts. I enjoyed contacts and always made it a big part of my practice. I'm doing conventional lenses like we all did. I mean, I was trained in the days of PMMAs and gas permeables, so I was very familiar with corneal lenses, and of course soft lenses, you know, became popular. But in any case, I was going along to a three-doctor practice, quite busy. And like most big practices, I saw keratoconus patients and fit them with the conventional cone-type lenses, sometimes hybrids. I knew about scleral lenses. I became aware of scleral designs somewhere about 2005, 2008. But I just, you know, I was busy practice and that seemed quite specialized. And so I wasn't keen on it. However, I have a very close relationship with corneal specialists. We graduated the same time and he's been my main cornea guy and he's sent me a lot of patients. And what happened was I had, you know, a pretty severe cone that I thought was time for a graft. And so I sent him to my cornea doc, and cornea doc sends him back, said, no, fit him in a scleral. And I knew what a scleral was, so I thought, well, I don't have time. I said, I don't have time for this, you know, and I'm not set up for it. And so his suggestion was send it to the University of Houston, to actually one of my professors. And so I did. I said, that's fine, you know, go to U of H. And then this happened the second time where I sent a patient, sent him back. And so when I had my third keratoconus, and I, you know, I had a few like most people, and of course we have a lot of post archaic tasias because RK was very popular. Now, there's a lot of ophthalmologists in the Houston area. We have a very big medical community, and so we had these ectasias. So I thought, well, on the third one, I thought, well, I'll just have to man up and learn this. And so I took it upon myself to become educated. I went to a seminar, a full day seminar where there was a wet lab, and I bought a kit, you know, and, yeah. And the next cone that came in, I thought, well, let me try it. And I was very lucky, you know, not knowing really anything. I just kind of followed the fitting guide and stuck a lens on. And this was a patient who had worn RGPs for keratoconus. And I put it on and I just was lucky, beginner's luck. It fit great, centered well. And the patient just, you know, got this wide-eyed look and go, oh, this is amazing. You know, this is really comfortable. And so I thought, well, dang, you know, I'm onto something. So I have made it a focus. And over the last 7 years, I've pretty much focused on scleral lenses and been very excited to do so.
So you've really followed the curve as they've developed in interest, particularly in the United States. I mean, the development path in the United States has been much steeper than it has elsewhere in the world. You know, where do you see practice going now?
Well, as you know, Martin, there's been a big interest in the last few years on scleral profilometry, and been a number of very good studies now that, you know, have taught us a lot about scleral architecture, if you will. And we all remember our ocular anatomy and the spiral of Tollot and the distance of the extraocular muscles, you know, from the limbus. But when you start fitting sclerals and, you know, start struggling with centering the lenses, it really becomes evident, you know, how toric and asymmetric. And of course, there's some studies that indicate, you know, as many as 2/3 of our patients have a highly irregular sclera that we're trying to fit.
Yeah, so we spoke to Greg Denayer earlier, and right, obviously, right. And Pat Caroline also were, you know, part of this study that's come up with this. And
I referenced them a lot, that the study that Greg and Sanders and Jason Jedlicka and some other people did in 2017 was landmark, and that's where I got that two-thirds number exactly. Greg Denier, pioneer.
I know I was at the GSLS as you were earlier this year, and there was a lot of talk about the use of diagnostic sets. Now, here in the UK, we went through a phase, I think it was the 90s, it seems an age ago, where we had mad cow disease, CJD, and we weren't allowed to use fitting sets. Now, that more or less killed off the GP business in the UK for many, many practitioners who had grown up with using a fitting set. You're telling, I've heard now that similar moves are occurring for different reasons within the United States. Perhaps you'd like to explain to the rest of us, you know, what's going on there.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, continuing on the theme of, you know, being able to map the sclera with some new instrumentation. The movement, and I think this has been coming. You referenced GSLS. The American Optometric Association released some guidelines on disinfection. There's an article that'll be published next month in the Optometry and Vision Science by Melissa Barnett, and it's guidelines for handling and disinfecting multi-use, you know, diagnostic lenses in the U.S. And they're quite onerous, quite frankly, you know, in terms of what we really need to do. And this was in January before COVID. And I think what COVID's going to do is, I think this is our equivalent of mad cow disease. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, patients are going to be reluctant to, you know, where's this lens been? Who is it on? You know, they're going to be, and as we ramp up in America, and I'm sure as you will in the UK, we're going to slowly increase the number of patient visits. We're going to spread them out in time. So we're not going to see as many people, and time is going to be even more of a premium. So I think where this is heading is empirical fitting, where if we can take a patient, take a scan of them, maybe take an auto refraction and say, right, you're good. I'm going to order you a lens just for you, a virgin lens, so to speak. And then you'll come back and you get that lens. There's ways that you can, you know, come up with a prescription, you know, through your spectacle refraction in case, of course, we do this with corneal lenses all the time. And then some manufacturers are even going the extra mile of saying, okay, we'll make you the first lens based on your measurements, and it'll be a plano lens. And then you'll get that lens. We know it'll fit. You may have some minor tweaks, but maybe not. And that is your diagnostic lens, and we'll order it. And they're going to do that at no charge. And so I personally think that's where it's going to go. I think we're going to go straight to empirical fitting as the norm in a very short period of time. Because that way, then we're not futzing around with, oh, is this quad? You know, how much toricity? Where's the toricity? Do I need to be quad? Do I need, you know, an oval optical zone? You know, whether you scan it on the instruments or whether you actually take an impression mold, like, you know, guys like Ken Pullum in the UK, they're right down the road from you and been doing for years, and others. You don't worry about all that. That lens is going to fit because it's going to, you know, mirror all the lumps and bumps and irregularities that are present. So empirical fitting.
But that obviously can't be done without the use of these new instruments, these profilometers that you mentioned. As I spoke to Greg Denea last week, and he was describing one of them, the SMAP, that he's closely involved with. Are you familiar with that? What are you actually using in your practice?
I'm not using the SMAP, but friends of mine who are, you know, say it's an excellent instrument, and the studies that Greg and his team have published are quite impressive. I use a Pentacam. I'm a fan of Oculus and Pentacam, and their scleral mapping software is called Corneal Scleral Profiler, CSP. I also have an Eaglet from the Netherlands, the Eaglet Scleral Profiler, ESP. I use them both. They're different. They have different attributes. For the average practitioner, I don't think you have to have both. I'm fortunate that I'm able to have both. And so they're different. And it's interesting to contrast and compare, you know, the two instruments. With either instrument, whichever one you use, they will point you to your first diagnostic lens. If you still want to use a diagnostic lens, they will suggest the parameters of that. Or as I said, I think many manufacturers are willing to, use that software to design the first lens empirically and send you that trial.
So the software is linked directly to the manufacturer, and so you still have a choice of lens manufacturers to use. You're not linked to just one particular manufacturer.
That is correct. The Eaglet and the Oculus, you know, you can work with whomever you would like.
I think practitioners in Europe will be familiar with the name Oculus, obviously, and the Eaglet Eye has been present in and around Europe for several years now. So. I think they'll be familiar with the technology that they're using. Do you think the labs they find this favorable? Do you think that it cuts down on their remakes, the fact that you have so much information up front?
I would hope so. We're still at the start of this, and with this COVID, we haven't had any. activity. However, I was starting this even before COVID. And I think they're going to be quite excited. I've done a couple of these empirical lenses off both instruments that I mentioned, the Oculus and the Eaglet, and they're spot on. I mean, they are much better than a lot of diagnostic lenses. And the issue is Christine Sent, who I know you know from iPrint Pro. She told me is when I first started doing iPrint Pro, which is the impression mold process, a few years ago, they approached me and, you know, I said, well, you know, I like scleral and I do scleral, but I don't think, you know, I don't see that dramatic a case. And she says, well, the more you do this, the more you will. And that's absolutely true. So, as you get more and more complicated cases, and if you're trying to fit them diagnostically, to be quite honest, you know, you take your measurements and you put on a lens and it's not right. You put on another lens, it's not right. And you said, well, I better try another brand. You know, by the time you get on your third diagnostic lens, two things happen. The patient gets very fatigued. Yeah. And then you start looking like, you know, you really, you know, are struggling. Does this person know what they're doing? And so with empirical fitting, that first lens is going to be a heck of a lot closer than anything you've been struggling with at a trial set. And I think it'll increase your efficiency, increase your success, and make patients happier. They're not thrilled with putting lens after lens after lens on their eye.
Well, of course, that's if you can do it in one visit. But of course, very often it requires ordering a lens from a laboratory, a wait, a revisit, which again, in these COVID times, we'll be trying to minimize when we actually get back into practice.
We'll take a break from the conversation at this point and rejoin at a later date. If you've enjoyed the video so far, remember to like, share, and subscribe. Thank you once more, and I'll see you next time.